Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture, and hopefully the most Renaissance-like manner in which arts and culture can be discussed, so please stay tuned for that. Now, I don't particularly wish to discuss Star Wars, that is, the new Star Wars movies that Disney is releasing, either in a Renaissance-like manner or any other kind of manner, and I did a video called I'm Too Disco, for the new Star Wars movies, which hopefully everyone can agree on, is the most Leonardo da Vinci's contribution to culture in about 200 years. And if we can't all agree on it, then, well, perhaps that's all the more reason to do a new video that hopefully is more Leonardo-esque. But anyway, let's not get too hung up on all things Renaissance-y, because I don't so much want to do this video discussing the new Star Wars movies, but rather discussing how it is that reception, how it is that the audience's reaction to those new Star Wars movies is dividing our market somehow. And basically, I mean, some YouTube channels that I've recently gotten into and started liking, I found out to my shock that some people basically decided to not keep following Red Letter Media's YouTube channel once they saw that they didn't just outright pan every Disney Star Wars release. Basically, there were audience members who they hate those new Star Wars releases with such a passion that they cannot accept any other kind of discussion about them except just mercilessly mocking every Rian Johnson or whoever else is making the decisions every moment in those new releases. So basically, two things have rather surprised me about hearing some Star Wars fans talk about Star Wars in the recent couple of months. And one of the surprises is that there are actually quite a lot of people who love the prequels, which to me is a completely shocking stance. Because I can understand somebody not hating them. I mean, the prequels aren't doing anything too aggravating. So, like, once something like Jar Jar Binks isn't on the screen, or the rather peculiar attempts at romance that's happening in Attack of the Clones, once those kinds of moments aren't on, there's not necessarily anything that's necessarily making me hate the movies, but those seem like fairly average, uninspired releases. So the idea that they are inspiring love from some people is surprising to say the least, and of course Red Letter Media rather famously pointed out a couple of shortcomings here and there in those movies, and by a couple of shortcomings, I guess somebody might think that literally everything would have been unideal to some fans of the original trilogy. Now, anyway, as I suggested, I've been rather surprised by some people loving prequels more than I thought that anyone could love them, and then the kind of levels of hatred that some people started feeling towards, say, The Last Jedi or something, and basically how it is that that is splitting the fandom, in that it's as if you can only take two positions. Either you love and defend everything that Disney Star Wars movies stand for, or you accuse them of everything and dismiss them on all levels. Apparently Red Letter Media didn't get the memo that you either had to have 100% approval rating are 100% vote of no confidence. So anyway, if I also missed that memo, and well, I'm sure some other people who may be watching this may also have missed it. But anyway, I won't try to do any, like, I won't play with that. I mean, I'm not going to play that game. So I'm not going to either 100% approve of them, 100% disagree with them, but rather I would just suggest the idea that how many franchises have been relevant past, say, 8 movies or something. Like, the James Bond film franchise is kind of an outlier in this sense that the James Bond franchise seems to have pretty gracefully accepted the kind of peaks and valleys, in that I hope no one is suggesting that something like Diamonds Are Forever would be as good as, say, Goldfinger, or that no one would suggest that Moonraker would be as good as, For Your Eyes Only is a Roger Moore film that I greatly like. But anyway, like, there is sort of naturally better and worse entries to the Bond franchise. So it seems like with every actor, they get a couple of hits, a couple of misses, and then they just replace the actor and the franchise just keeps going. So the Bond franchise is kind of a strange, I suggested that it's an outlier, that most franchises can't operate the way that the Bond franchise is operating. Because, you know, those are massive tentpole releases whenever they are happening. So, it's rare that you would have that many, you know, movies that cost something like $200 million in a franchise. Well, yeah, I don't know if Bond films cost necessarily that much, but anyway, they are expensive enough, and it's rare to have that kind of longevity. But certainly for most franchises, the more you keep adding movies to the franchise, the less relevant its subsequent entry is. So basically, it shouldn't be, I mean, people should accept that it's the norm that a franchise won't be particularly special by the time you get to the fourth entry, or fifth entry, or sixth entry, or whatever. So just look at the Star Wars. Most people think that the first film, well, most people who would have any positive feelings towards Star Wars maybe think that either the first film is the best, or the first film is the second best, and then The Empire Strikes Back would be the best. But anyway, like, the overwhelming consensus is just the two best films in the franchise would be the first and the second one. And then some people think that there's a drop-off from the second to the third one, and then a massive drop-off from Return of the Jedi to The Phantom Menace. So basically, if there was from an initial high point a drop from the first two to the third one, and from the third one to the fourth, fifth, sixth, and then some people think that there's maybe a slight bump upwards, and then just a drop off from there, in that it just seems like the trend for the Star Wars movies is for them to be less relevant than the original trilogy was, and then, some people try to, defend them into relevance or something, but honestly, I mean, I do think that the people who are claiming to love the new Star Wars releases, I mean, they do seem as absurd as the people who are loving the prequel trilogy, and that if somebody loves them, good for you. But I mean, it does seem like a pretty strange position. Like, imagine if Coppola's Godfather trilogy, if Coppola just wanted to center a new trilogy around Andy Garcia, or some sort of a prequel trilogy around somebody else playing the Robert De Niro role of young Vito. Like, if the Godfather trilogy, instead of, like, if it had a sequel trilogy and a prequel trilogy, like, if Godfather 3 is already indicative of the franchise starting to run out of steam, like, what would happen to some sort of a young Vito trilogy where some new actor is playing the Robert De Niro? I mean, it wouldn't be any good. At least, not any good in the sense that Godfather 1 and 2. And, you know, I'm usually the resident defender for Godfather Part 3. I don't think it's that bad. It just has a couple of sequences that maybe should have been a bit better. But I think the Godfather 3 has some things going for it. But again, it's a noticeable drop-off in quality. But, like, you can already see just how the quality would fall off a cliff if Coppola did a prequel trilogy and a sequel trilogy. And basically, that seems to be where Star Wars is at. Like, just like The Godfather needed to be left in the three film storytelling place where it was left off. I mean, Star Wars, I'm not saying that it couldn't survive more entries in the series, but at most it would have entered the kind of James Bond situation where you go through the kind of cycles of up and down, and that you know, it moves in like four film units where you have one or two hits and then a couple of misses, and then you just keep repeating a cycle like that. You know, I would be open to the idea of another Star Wars movie directed by somebody other than George Lucas of being good, but it just doesn't seem to be realistic. Just like with some Godfather prequel and sequel trilogy, like, you know, if someone else would start directing those, like, I mean, I wouldn't make any kind of wow to hate those movies and just assume that they have to be horrible, but there's every indicator, if you look at some historical models for franchises that just go on and on and on, that it's overwhelmingly probable that they won't come out at all well. So I think that that's the reasonable stance to take on Star Wars, is that, like, you know, Jaws has some sequels and no one thinks that they're any good. You know, William Friedkin's Exorcist has sequels, and let's say those certainly aren't as well regarded as the original. Did people start making some sequels to the Gus Van Sant Psycho reboot or something? Like, again, those aren't considered very good. The Alien franchise has more entries that I can even count right now. Does it have something like 7 or 8 if you count the Alien versus Predator films? Like, the Alien has a maximum amount of 2 great movies in that franchise. Same thing with the Terminator. There's just starting, I mean, they're doing other Terminator things. The timeline is a joke at this point. And you know, the Terminator series, it has a maximum amount of 2 great movies. And basically, a lot of these people who are defending the new Disney releases, I mean, they are as laughable as those who are claiming that the Alien franchise is going from strength to strength to strength, or that the Terminator franchise is just getting better and better. Like, no one would take that seriously. So, anyway, a lot of the people who are criticizing the kind of morality of people who are dissing these new Star Wars movies. Like, I don't understand what they're smoking. Like, it's the most obvious thing ever that the Terminator films, that the recent Terminator films haven't been any good. Like, I can sort of accept Terminator 3 as not that bad. I can sort of accept the Christian Bale Terminator, is it the fourth one, of having a couple of moments, but again, you know, the quality just, it does fall off from a cliff. And basically, you know, when Ridley Scott or James Cameron stop being involved in some of those franchises and know if they're an executive producer or something, it doesn't count as proper involvement. You know, when Ridley Scott and James Cameron stopped working on those movies and they were replaced by, let's face it, less talented directors. I mean, I know that that's harsh to say of David Fincher and Jean-Pierre Jeunet that, you know, like, I mean, you know, Fincher, let's put it this way, he had a raw deal on Alien 3. Like, Fincher didn't really get to do what he wanted, and perhaps he wasn't entirely ready for that kind of a stage. But anyway, like, whatever we think of Fincher, there's no way that anyone can defend Alien 3. It's just not... There is no level on which Alien 3 is as successful as Alien 1 or Aliens. So, you know, I'm not trying to diss Fincher. I think he's a fine director, but, you know, he's not really in his element in that one. And it's interesting to note that David Fincher actually was offered to direct Star Wars Force Awakens, and he turned it down, potentially due to bad experiences on Alien 3. To me this feels like just like stating the obvious time and time again, but because people are taking such random stances with these new Star Wars releases, I guess there is some kind of, I don't know whether, like, it doesn't seem like there's any demand for stating the obvious, but perhaps there's some kind of value in what to me seems like a common sense take. So anyway, it's just like, I mean, what I am suggesting is that Star Trek movies, I think, I would like to think that most people probably regard that the first and the second one, especially Wrath of Khan as the second one, that the first two Star Trek movies would be the two best one, and then it enters the kind of James Bond type situation that there's like this very mild peaks and then valleys, and very mild peaks and then I really do think that Star Wars movies are entering a cycle like that. So, you know, if in James Bond movies the peaks are higher and the valleys are lower than with Star Trek movies, like, you know, if Quantum of Solace is bad, I mean, it's way worse than any Star Trek movie. And if Die Another Day is bad, then, you know, again, it's way worse than any Star Trek movie. But then, like, you know, we see in Star Trek movies, we see in Alien movies, we see in Terminator movies, after the franchise stopped being special, when the most talented directors of an era were doing their best work with them, after a franchise stops being special, then it either has mild peaks, mild values, or wild peaks and wild valleys. Basically, it seems like Star Wars franchise, it's just either it sets to the wild peaks, wild values, or mild peaks, mild valleys, that mode. But anyway, like, anyone who tries to explain the situation as if it's going from strength to strength to strength, I mean, those people are either disingenuous or they're, well, talking as if they're smoking crack, as far as I'm concerned. But anyway, so I just wanted to put a more serious Star Wars related idea out there for whomever it may concern. And so I'm not necessarily exactly boycotting any Star Wars releases, but I think it's highly unlikely that I would ever watch another again, because it's just same thing with Alien and Terminator. Like, it just seems like they're sort of in the basement as far as quality is concerned. And so it just seems like Star Wars is going that way. And it's a shame, because, like, I can see how Star Wars could have gone the James Bond route. Like, I can just see the Bond franchise, like, when Sean Connery exited Bond, there was a brief period of strangeness. Like, Connery, I think, had a couple of returns. Was Diamonds Are Forever a return for him, and then Never Say Never Again? Was that directed by Irving Kershner? I think Connery returned maybe twice, and then George Lazenby, he was only there for one movie, and then I don't entirely know what happened, but like, the Bond franchise has like some major level turbulence when it came to replacing the actor, and they just couldn't quite make a smooth transition for the next phase. And it's only when Roger Moore solidified himself as Bond that the franchise was kind of saved, in that now they had the kind of smooth way of transitioning from one actor to the other and so on. And I think all of the post-Moore handoffs seem like they've happened fairly smoothly, I don't think there's, when Daniel Craig was first cast, there was some fan backlash, but then people saw Casino Royale and then everyone was feeling good again. Basically, I think that something like that, I can see how something like that could have happened to Star Wars. Let's say if these first Disney releases would be like that kind of Diamonds Are Forever, Never Say Never Again, On Her Majesty's Secret Service type situation, that people can't entirely see a reasonable continuum from the past to the present to the future. Like, Star Wars really is needing its own Roger Moore type figure. And basically, there is a lot of potential in the Star Wars universe. It could so easily turn out well. I'm sure something like 80 or 90% of the fans could get massively hyped for some Knights of the Old Republic type projects. If there was some project about Mace Windu's youth or something, I'm sure a massive amount of fans might forgive everything, just ignore The Last Jedi and act like this kind of turbulence period isn't even happening. The Star Wars definitely can be saved, but right now it just seems like the franchise is in tailspin. And speaking of spin, a lot of the media around the franchise is just looking at the reception that The Last Jedi had and is saying that everything is fine. Looking at the box office that Solo had and it's like everything is fine. Are looking at some of the... let's just say that the screenplay of The Last Jedi didn't necessarily put the ninth mainline feature into the best position. And, some people are looking at that, looking at trying to have outtakes of Carrie Fisher in there, and people are looking at that and saying everything is fine, and that's all total spin. And the last thing that the Disney Star Wars franchise, the last position where they are is fine. But I can definitely see how they could transition away from this mess if they can just find the kind of Roger Moore type level. That, you know, not everyone who loves Bond is into the Roger Moore type films. Like, not everyone who is a Bond fan is a fan of every era of the character. But, you know, there's enough there for, well, there to be something for everyone. I can see how Star Wars might transition into that that point, but right now it's just looking like it's going the Alien way and not the Bond way. And yeah, and you know, especially the kind of toxic conversation culture that has shaped around Star Wars, in that either you need to love everything or hate everything. Like, I mean, what kind of a fan base can get away acting like that? I mean, that's just, that is completely nonsensical. Like, you know, Los Angeles Lakers basketball fans aren't put in a position that they have to love everything or hate everything. You know, fans of Japanese kabuki theater aren't put in a position where they have to love everything or hate everything. You know, fans of Italian cuisine aren't put in a position that they have to love everything or hate everything. Like, I mean, no sane fan base, no sane culture zone has to go about their business like that. So, you know, that's why I'm not really interested in joining that, in that you know, a lot of the people who have chosen the anti-Disney Star Wars stance, they would probably hate me saying that I actually liked Rian Johnson before going to The Last Jedi. Now, I didn't say it before, but I haven't yet seen The Last Jedi, and I will not watch it because it just seemed not good. You know, when Revenge of the Sith was released, I didn't go and see it in the theaters. I just, at some later point, I saw it on DVD and didn't think it, you know, I would have needed it to hold the higher ground, but it just couldn't do that. So, that's why I didn't watch it. And that's why I have zero plans of watching The Last Jedi, but perhaps, like, I mean, I didn't go to see The Force Awakens in theaters, I saw it on TV, and maybe something like that will happen with The Last Jedi. But anyway, so I did like Rian Johnson. I mean, I remember when Brick was released, and I was initially extremely interested in the kind of tongue-in-cheek, neo-noir type release, and I loved that movie. I mean, aesthetic is looking a bit rough, especially the exterior shots with available light on an overcast day. Like, I mean, those look incredibly rough right now, but I mean, there's some kind of interesting spirit to Rian Johnson's debut film, Brick. You know, Protest Bloom, it didn't come out. I mean, like, that was just a mess. And you know, I just feel like Rian Johnson was pushed into doing something with some kind of a Fox Searchlight aesthetic, and it doesn't seem to be really his thing. So, you know, it's kind of a random film. I have no idea what Rian Johnson himself thinks about how right he thinks Protest Bloom came out. Like, I think it's a similar bewildering mist that something like 1941 was from Spielberg, or well, Coppola has some movies that you just wonder why he did it. Like, well, I mean, some people like One from the Heart. It has some good things, but like as a follow-up to as a follow-up to a more legendary movie, it's you know, kind of a not great project. But anyway, then Looper, I thought that, you know, it was like a three-quarters great movie, and then you know, the third act needed to be more epic and maybe, you know, there were some periods of transition in that movie that I didn't entirely like, but basically I thought that Looper showed great promise and, you know, I don't understand why people need to kind of unpurse on Rian Johnson just because The Last Jedi was a mess. I mean, wasn't The Phantom Menace an unideal Star Wars movie? Wasn't The Clone Wars an unideal Star Wars movie? Wasn't Revenge of the Sith an unideal Star Wars movie? You know, Force Awakens was just a soft reboot of an earlier, better movie. I didn't see Rogue One. Maybe it came out better than some of the others, but like Solo seemed to be a Justice League type mess with two directors just throwing a bunch of stuff there and hoping that you like it. And isn't there kind of a trend of unideal release after another, after another, after another? Like, I mean, yes, you could say that Rian Johnson messed things up more than those other directors, but like, I mean, I don't want to participate in any kind of tribalism. Like, I'd rather just ignore everything Star Wars related if like all there is two tribes and both with a goatee mentality and they won't listen to anything if you don't just have the right rubber stamp and then just stamp out those problems. But anyway, like I'm not categorically against new Star Wars releases. I can halfway see how it is that the franchise could be saved, but I'm assuming that they won't release anything great anytime soon, and certainly some personal changes need to happen. Because, like, you know, some of those James Bond directors, they are kind of underrated. Like, there's a bewildering interview with Robert Bresson, of all freaking people, is complimenting John Glenn's cinematographic writing. Like, Robert Bresson said that he loved some John Glenn Bond film. And, like, Martin Campbell, he's also kind of a sneakily underrated director. Like, Irving Kershner, his Bond film didn't come out particularly well. But, like, there's some interesting directors. Like, some of the Pierce Brosnan Bonds, they didn't come out the way people wanted them. But, like, you know, Lee Tamahari and Roger Spottiswood, like, they're sort of more interesting directors than people give them credit for. I feel like, obviously, you know, an interesting director can swing and miss. And basically, I would suggest that, like, Rian Johnson hired to do a Star Wars movie is a bit like somebody like Roger Spottiswood or Lee Tamahari hired to do a Bond film in that it's not necessarily the best person to project situation because, like, you know, ultimately the most famous Bond films are done by faintly journeyman-esque directors. And, you know, it's interesting to contrast that when George Lucas didn't direct Star Wars 5 and 6, he hired directors, I mean, he interviewed some people like David Lynch and David Cronenberg, but he ultimately hired two fairly journeyman-esque directors in Kershner and Marquand. And basically, it seemed like perhaps there is some sort of a sweet spot in that if you hire slightly flashier screenwriter and slightly more middle-of-the-road directors, maybe something like that could be the balance to save Star Wars. Because, like, a director who isn't in charge of the writing themselves, they can function like an editor and basically take out whatever kind of gaudy excesses that some flashier screenwriters might want to put in there. And maybe, like, some balance like that could could be what saves Star Wars. Basically, I would say that why The Last Jedi failed as spectacularly it seems to have failed is that same thing with prequels. At Empire Strikes Back, George Lucas arranged for balance in that he had a co-writer to balance out his ideas, and he had a director to balance out his producer involvement. And that kind of counterbalance seems to have created the biggest line of quality in Empire Strikes Back and Last Jedi. There wasn't a balance to the prequel trilogy. And again, it seems like this sequel trilogy didn't learn anything from the mistakes of the prequel trilogy, in that Rian Johnson needed a co-writer and somebody else to balance his ideas. And because they didn't do it, that's what leaves the tonality in The Last Jedi in an unbalanced condition. Some people feel like, Kathleen Kennedy very evidently felt like, the Lawrence and, was it John Kasdan or Jake Kasdan? The Kasdans and Kathleen Kennedy clearly felt like Lord and Miller when they were doing Solo, a Star Wars story. They felt like they wanted a balance to the Lord and Miller, and it seems like there was a perception that Lord and Miller just took over the project, just did whatever they wanted, but there was enough counterbalance to replace them then with Ron Howard, and there wasn't any comparable counterbalance to The Last Jedi, and that's, there seems to be this kind of trend of unbalanced releases as far as the tonalities are concerned. And basically, I think that the formula that seems to have been proven to work with Star Wars is that you have a producer who counterbalances the director, and then screenwriter team that counterbalances the producer and director. And it seems like that creates some sort of a stable, harmonious tonality that fans seem to find appealing. And something like that needs to start happening to Star Wars if they want to be more like James Bond and less like the Alien franchise. And who knows whether Star Wars can fix itself. I won't apologize that I liked Looper and Brick when they came out. I'm not going to be rude to Rian Johnson just because he had one swing and miss film release. I'm not going to be rude to I'm trying not to be rude to the people who like the Star Wars prequels or the sequels, or who don't like the prequels or the sequels. Star Wars clearly inspires more devotion than basically any other film franchise out there, but my personal feeling is that Star Wars has ceased to be special, and the last special moment in Star Wars was Return of the Jedi, and then, the rest is just a cash grab. But, if some people want to like that cash grab or don't want to like that cash grab, well, it's their thing. But I won't be looking for any new Star Wars releases. I think more and more people will probably start casually having that attitude, which is the attitude that they have towards Terminator and Alien. And it's not because they're against this group or that group, it's not about, not accepting whoever is directing those movies, whoever is acting in those movies. It's that some franchises get played out because there's too many movies, and they all start, it all starts looking like the Police Academy franchise or something. And this was a more serious take on Star Wars than I'm too disco for Star Wars, but I just felt like making it, and I don't know who's interested, but well, yeah. I think that's about it. So I'll do one more Star Wars video, one more Rian Johnson video, and then I can go back to mostly ignoring all this stuff. But yeah, thanks for watching this one, and if you like this video, I hope that you'll consider liking some other videos as well. But anyway, that's all for now, thanks for watching, and bye bye.